right. We just wanted to have Brother David to come down. David, pastor.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
This young man has a great call on his life. We just want him to just give you a little bit about what God has done for him recently. I'll let him tell it all. All right, come on.
Amen. God is good, amen. So for the story, I guess it really makes sense. I have to go back. So I got saved and gave my life to God when I was 6 years old. And I'm 37 here today. And I grew up actually in a Baptist church. So in the time that I was growing up, speaking in tongues and all those types of things, even dance, I didn't see a lot of that growing up. It's a lot more prevalent now because a lot of change in 20, 30 years or whatever. But it wasn't that way when I grew up. So understanding tongues was not something that I understood. So basically, as I got older, I saw the works of the Holy Ghost, and they scared me because I saw people acting real strange, like they were falling out and bucking and doing all this kind of stuff. So it kind of made me feel uncomfortable. I'm like, what's that? That don't seem right. But it's not like what we see here. It was very extreme. But anyway, when I got into college, I was filled with the Holy Ghost early in my my sophomore year in college. And I laid out on the floor and I was out for a long time. And I was staggering out of the church. I couldn't drive myself home. Somebody had to drive me home. And I spoke in a little bit of tongue, but that was it. It was just a little bit. There have been many times since then that hands have been laid on me, and a lot of ministers emphasize the speaking in tongues, something that they didn't explain to me, but they emphasized it so much. And there was one time I felt that it was me that was doing the tongue. It wasn't really the Holy Ghost. It was just me. So it was in my flesh. But they let me alone, and I went on about my business. But on Tuesday, hallelujah, we came in here, and we were having our regular service. And Pastor, I was over there, and I was holding Judah, and Precious was beside me. I sat him down, because I know this is not a moment to hold on to the baby right now. But when he laid his hands on me, I spoke in tongues, and it was effortless. And I spoke for, I don't know if it was 20 minutes, 30 minutes, I can't tell you how long it was. But it wasn't me, it was the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And I tell you what, I feel like a new man. Amen. And I'm not one to do things for show. I'm not going to stand up here and put on a show or anything like that. That's not me. But I know that I have tongues. Amen. And I know that I've had the Holy Ghost. I've had the Holy Ghost. But speaking in tongues, again, is something I did not understand. And it's not something that I focused on, I practiced, or whatever. But I have the Holy Ghost. And I'm just thankful to God that, like I said, I feel like a new man. And the devil better be ready now. He probably has a problem. He sure got one now.
Sister Eva, you want to add something? I was impressed yesterday. She was in prayer, and she got rededicated or reconsecrated or whatever, recommitment last Sunday. It was wonderful. We were all just moved by her commitment and her decision. And yesterday she said that God showed me that this church is going to be full, and I want to be one that can fill it up. So I was really impressed by that. So we're just going to have a word from her and then from a few more.
Praise the Lord, saints. I give honor to Jesus, who's first in my life. It's for my pastor, First Lady, that I've known for. I think I came here when I was 21 and gave my life to the Lord. And through these years, I've been to some churches. But I just want to say this before I say anything. Be grateful that you're here. Because these preachers today, they're not teaching the Word of God.
You're right.
It's about show. It's almost like you're you're going to see some type of play put on about going to church. And I was sitting in a church and the Lord just started dealing with me, telling me to look around, and I was looking around and he was saying, you see the women here? Where are the husbands? Where are the husbands? Where they have children? So where are the fathers? And then he said, look around. I looked around again and he said, where are the men? The real men. And I asked church and said, Lord, where do you want me to go? He said, I want you to go back from where you came in the beginning. And when you get there, I'll show you what to do. So please pray for me. Because every time I lay before the Lord, I see this church now. And I see what I seen in the 70s and 80s. Just filled. No room. The Lord is going to bless this church. Because Pastor Hill is a man that don't mind telling you the truth. And that's what we're here for. We want to hear the word of God. And in boldness. You need holy boldness. When you see something out of order, correct that thing. Don't leave it there. I was in a church. When I would hug the young ladies, they smelled like cigarettes, marijuana, liquor, like they had just walked out of a club. I know, because I used to do it. So I know, it's a familiar spirit. And I was like, Lord, I can't do this anymore. Please show me somewhere else to go. But so much, God got so much, because I was coming to this church when I was carrying that baby. And then 5 o'clock in the morning, I was at this altar, laying before God with that baby. And I went to Azusa. And when I went to Azusa, the pastor that was ministering that night, Miles Monroe, he said, there's a woman here, she's pregnant and don't want her child. He said, don't get rid of that baby. The baby was called by God. He said, come up here, I want to pray for you. I didn't get up. I stayed. Because when he said it, about 200 people went up there. And if you're familiar with Azusa, it's like 10,000 people be there. So like 200 women went, so I said, well, he's not talking to me. But after he prayed for all of those women, he said, the one I want didn't come up here. The one I'm waiting on didn't come up here. And it was as if he looked straight at me, and I'm way up here. And Sister Brown came in and said, Eva, why do you always do this when someone's trying to prophesy to you? Get up and go down there to that preacher. I said, come go with me. And I walked down. He said, you are the one. He had this lady lay her hand on my stomach. My child danced in my stomach. He started preaching when he was three. He started preaching to my clientele of people. And at that time I had a large clientele. Beauty shop was filled. My three-year-old son running through there, preaching and saying, get right, you gotta get your house right, God's coming back. And they was like, whose child is that? I said, it's my child. How old is he? I said, he's three. A man came to shoot a man in the beauty shop. My child went to that man and said, don't do this, you're gonna make God so unhappy. Don't kill this man. He said, whose child is this? I said, he's mine. He said, I'm not gonna do this. I done seen kids rap, dance, everything, but nobody talked about the Lord. I'm not gonna do it. He said, you lucky man. He told the guy under the drive, you lucky. Because I came here to kill you. So please, thank you.
Brother Simon, you wanted to come. Just kind of recapture what you did Sunday evening.
Amen. Good morning, everybody. I just want to say thank you, Jesus. I kind of a long story, but I'm going to try to compress it. And it starts out with spending time with God, lots of time in prayer, Monday prayer, Tuesday morning prayer, fourth Saturday prayer, personal time prayer, and just having a genuine concern for your loved ones and your close ones, your friends, and your friends are like family. Some of you may know that a very, very, very close friend of mine passed away last month, who was like a brother to me. And he was also one who I was concerned about and praying for and trying to reach intensely. I come from a group of friends. We all like brothers. It's a group of six of us. It's five now. But with the loss of my brother, bless you. With the loss of my brother, it kind of touched the hearts of all of us. And not just the core group of friends, but the extended group of friends as well. And I've been doing my part to, you know, share the word with them. Yes. And when I share the word, it's not like, you know, man, you should come to church. I really think you should pray. Like, hey, man, you know what time it is. Tomorrow's not promised, and yes, time will run out on you. And each one of us is accountable for each other.
Yes.
And if I know and don't tell you, that means that I'm accountable.
Yes. Yes.
So, as believers, we all are accountable for those in our core circle and those that we have communication with, fellowship with, in and outside of church.
Yes.
You're responsible for those people's whereabouts and their spirituality and their souls.
Yes.
And the loss of my friend, it hurt because I lost a loved one, but it also hurt because I was unsure about his relationship with God. And I don't know if you ever lost someone who was close to you and you were unsure about that. And that's a pain that's like no other. I mean, I cried for days, weeks. But during that time, I had a event, which was the day after the loss of my brother. And I came to church and dropped off my tithe. I notified Pastor Hill about what happened. And I believe Pastor Hill seen the pain in me, but I told Pastor Hill, I said, I'm okay. I know I got work to do. And I'm gonna allow God to use me. And that's one of the prayers that I say every time that I have time with the Lord. Jesus, Lord, Father, just use me. Use me as a vessel. Use me as a tool. Work through me, you know. And God has been doing that. I know you guys remember a young lady about the age of my daughter, Sue, was coming with us. Mimi and her mother, Nikitha, had called me one day and they were having a feeling. So I told them to come with me to prayer. They came with me to prayer, and Nikitha gave her life to God that day. Nikitha is not one of my core friends. She's an extension of one of my core friends. She's the girlfriend of one of my best friends. And she got saved that day. And she had scheduled to come and get baptized. She had a hectic work schedule, so she couldn't get baptized when we had the whole group here. So Pastor Hill made a special day just for her last Sunday. And a friend of mine, who's like my brother, her boyfriend, came with her that day to support her. And man, I love my pastor. Pastor Hill,
amen.
He keeps it real. He approached me and said, how you feeling? You want to get saved? And he said, yeah. Pastor said, you want to get saved today? And my friend said, yes, which shocked me. He didn't have clothes or anything, you know, but we were here to get Nikita baptized. And he said that he was ready. He stepped up to the front of the church and he took his confession and gave his life to God that day.
Yes.
Which was last Sunday. And just so happened he had extra pair of shorts in the car. So he went and grabbed his shorts and they took him on into that water. And it was so shocking to me because, you know, I've been praying to get all my friends saved. You know, when you love somebody, you want to see them in the afterlife. You know, you want to see them when you go to be with Christ. You don't want to be with no strangers. You want to be with your loved ones.
Yes.
And it was so shocking to me that I couldn't even let the joy come out because I was like, Lord Jesus, boy, you're working.
Hallelujah.
And I've just been continuing to pray for them, continue to try to reach other people, you know, just continue to do me. And sometimes you paint yourself in a box, you know, you think, well, I'm a Christian, man. I need to be like this. I need to dress like this. And God knows who you are.
Yes.
And sometimes it takes different individuals to reach people differently.
That's right.
But I love Jesus. I am a God-fearing man. When some people see me on the streets, they probably don't see that in me. But if they have a conversation with me, they'll know exactly where I'm at. But sometimes people of the world they run from Christian people. I like to fool them. I step up to them. I step up to them. They think it's gonna be, hey, what's on? Hey, man, how's it going? God's good, ain't he? Indeed, he is. That's just one of the things. Just continue to let God use each and every one of us. Don't be afraid to open up your mouth and share the word because it's just been flowing through me from people at work, people at car shows. You know, you never know what people are going through because everybody, they seem like they're okay until you have 2 minutes alone with that person and just small talking. They'll start to reveal things to you, especially when you're working for God. So you just got to be prepared. You got to stay prayed up because you never know when you don't have time to prepare yourself. All right, I know
that's
I got to
right.
go reach this person.
That's right.
That person might be standing right there and you don't have time to prepare. You got to be ready already.
Yes.
So continue to pray.
Yes.
Continue to, the word I use is feed. You got to eat. You got to feed your spirit.
Amen.
Because what you take in is what's going to come out.
Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I got to stay eating. I mean that two ways. But God is good. I just want to say all the soldiers out there, keep going to work. Keep putting in the work.
Yes.
And like my auntie said, that's my auntie right there. She's feeling some of it too. You know, it's spreading out. But
yes.
That spirit of boldness, you got to let it shine through you. People of God, we can't be shy. We can't be timid because that's not how God designed us.
Right.
You have to be prepared for battle, prepared for war.
Come on.
And you can't duck, hide, or shy away from nobody. Because that's not the God that's in you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Well, we got a new crop of preachers coming on. It's one back there at the back, but Amen. He's gonna be all right. So stand up. That's all I'm gonna ask you to do. Stand up. He's trying to get his boldness together. He'll be all right. All right, Sister Denise, I want you to come because he left out Sister Nikita getting filled with the Holy Ghost, and Sister Denise took care of that. Come on, tell. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And also, who witnessed her daughter receiving the Holy Ghost, the 12-year-old? How many witnessed that? Sister Guanita, you remember that?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, Sister Nikita, Guanita, you might want to come and just kind of recap the children, because you were here all three or four times.
We love him though, don't we?
Yes, we do.
We were just back in the back, and that's my favorite room. That's my most favorite room in this entire building is out back there. Because I've ministered to so many. Thank you, Jesus. But this young lady, Jamie and I, we took her in the back, and it was just, as someone said, effortless. You know, I took her to, and I told Pastor, I'd like to use the passage, and he often uses this passage too, but I think he uses Acts 2 and another verse. But I like Acts 2:38, and I just quoted it to her, and I showed it to her in the Bible. And here Peter had just preached to the thousands, and he told them, he said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Lord Jesus, for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And I said, the gift is for you. And I showed her there that it said that in the Word, and like I said, it was so effortless. When we laid our hands up on her, Jamie and I raised her hands, and I said, now you just refuse to speak in English. I said, don't try to mimic Jamie and I. You just pray, and the Holy Spirit dwells in here in your belly. And we laid our hands on her, and she immediately began to speak in other tongues. So just continue to pray for her. Sammy said her boyfriend gave his life to the Lord, and I texted her this week, and I said, you have so many things to be thankful for, Nikita. And I said, there's so many decisions that you and your boyfriend are going to have to make, but God is going to be there with you. I haven't heard from her because I know that she's experienced a new life, and it's a change for young people, so please cover them. I don't know his name, Sammy. What's his name? Keontae and Nikita. Please pray for them this week.
Amen. All right. Have an old time testimony here, sir. All right. Sister Wayne, we want you to kind of give a report because I feel like God has put something together that we used to have maybe 10 or 15 years ago. And it's working. Amen. Probably going to work just as well or better. All right. Sister Guanita, she's the one that helped. Three or four sessions with the children. She's just going to tell you what God did.
Amen. I have to say that this has been a glorious time working with these kids, working with the young children. I can't say that I did it. It was God. God used several of us. The time that we had all the children lined up, I have to say the anointing was heavily on Sister Lakendo. God used her in a mighty way. She had the kids laying out. But just the duration of watching these kids flow and sing in the Spirit, it's been a beautiful process. It's been beautiful. And I was sitting there watching the kids that had been a part of this. You know, they're up and they're clapping. I have to say, because I know I watch my kids a lot, and my son is usually the clown. And instead of him clowning today, he's up clapping his hands and looked like he was really enjoying the men sing today. So, God has done such a marvelous work. And I want to say to all of us that there is such an urgency. Every time I'm up here praying, or any time I'm praying, there is just this urgency that we got to get things in order. Because we can't go after the harvest if we don't have it together. So our lives have to be like Brother Sammy said, he's feeding himself. Guys, it is time. It's time. We have to be about his business.
We've got to be about his business. All of this other stuff, television needs to be out, radio, everything, anything that doesn't have to bring glory to his name and that is not feeding your spirit, we got to start cutting out the fat. Because there is an urgency. I've been telling people, even my friend, I had a serious talk with him yesterday, and it's either God's way or it's the devil's way. There is no in between. There is no in between. Either you're for God or you're against him. So we've got to start telling people the truth and get rid of this fear. And the way we get rid of fear is that we've got to build ourselves up by praying in the spirit. So this is not only the kids' time, but this is our time to go after. There are so many people that are hurting, and they don't have an answer. Well, Jesus is the answer. He is the way, he is the truth, and he is the light. So we've got to be about his business. It's time for us. We've been in this thing long enough, and Pastor Hill is feeding us so much of this word. We should have it by now. So it's time for us to get out and compel them to come in. It's time. My son, the first day of school, called me with an issue at school. And you know what I had the opportunity to tell him? This is where your prayer language come in at, son. You don't run from the enemy no more because you have power. So the teachers that are telling you or that are giving you a hard time, you begin to pray. And last Friday when he came home, he was like, Mama, we had a good time in class today. So we're teaching the kids that they have power to cast out things that don't belong, to pull down vain imaginations, to stop the enemy in his tracks. We have that same power. So I just encourage us, the urgency for us to go out to reach people is now.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Lord, we just thank you for what you're doing. Hallelujah. As Pastor Hill said, this was birthed in prayer. 5 o'clock prayer. And it's the NCC care group. We're caring about our brothers and sisters. Pastor Hill in the Word showed us that it's three groups of people that we're supposed to be ministering to. The unsaved, the backslider, and the saved. Encourage the saved ones to stay encouraged. Don't get weary of well-doing. Continue to seek and to serve the Lord. So I'm excited of what God is doing because he's bringing us together. If you get a call, we're concerned about you. Pastor Hill, we're assisting Sister and Pastor Hill in these endeavors that the body, God is saying the body of NCC, the body of Christ, we need to come together where there's unity, there's strength. Because we have a job to do. We are well equipped in that sense. He has given us everything that we need for life and godliness. All the word, all the scriptures, all the packets he's given us, we are well equipped. So it's a time that we feed, like Sandy said, feed ourselves first, get in his presence first, and then we go. We go forth. We need this body together. He said he's given us every part of the body, gifts and talents. Every one of you have some gifts. Every one of us has some gifts. I remember months back, I was like, I know what Sister So-and-so's gift is and that, but and somebody might have heard me about it, but I don't know what my gift is. And the Lord showed me. When you ask him for something, he'll give you. I mean, woke me up in the middle of the night with a song. I was created to glorify him. We were created to glorify and magnify him. So I'm just encouraging this time that we're going to be encouraging one another. Fill up on his word and his will. Get it in us. And then when the opportunity comes, because it's all day long. All day long, we get up and praise him and worship and pray. He's going to bring us in the path, cross the path of somebody. You're going to be coming in contact with somebody that need to hear a word from God. I thank God for bringing me in the dressing room, Sister Eva. I was trying to get out to go do something. I'm like, I got something I'm going to do for the Lord, take this dinner. And she walked in. And I just thank God for that appointment, that divine appointment. So when we run into people, it's not an accident. You know, we want to hear from God. We want to get in His presence. You're going to hear. He's going to tell you what. He told me to open my mouth, and He'll fill it.
Amen.
So we got what we need inside. We got to open our mouths. Pray. If you don't have boldness, if you think you don't have boldness, pray for it. I remember years ago praying when I was working at Gilcrease. And the people would go for their break, and I would stay back there and pray in the Spirit. I prayed for boldness, and He'd bring one person, the produce person, in, and I would share and pray with. So, you know, if you feel like you need a little boldness, pray for it. He'll give it to you. Yes. Don't ask Him, because He will give it to you. Because in this time, the world is bold. We see it. If you turn on the TV or whatever, I was going home from the Y. And police everywhere, and I'm like, what in the world, Lord? Somebody done robbed the bank and all of this. I'm like, all day long they bold, so we gotta get on our job. Greater is He that's in us than he that's in the world. We can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. The joy of the Lord is my strength, and He's the strength of my life. So I just want to encourage you all to, if we call you, we're gonna be calling each other. We're going to be connected, reconnected, and strengthening our brothers and our sisters, that we all come together to do the work of the Lord.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
Amen.
Is there a minister or one or two that want to have something to say? Sister Precious, we want you to come down. That song, I was going to preach on. That the Lord be glorified, and you know, and us glorifying Him. And we just come on down and just give us a little bit more of that. Is there a minister that just want to have?
Sister Donaldson.
Okay, Sister Donaldson.
Good morning, everybody. Seems like it's been a long time since we've been back. But I was doing one of my devotions the other day, and I have a devotional that's through Smith Wigglesworth. And I think it'd be apropos to what, Pastor, you're doing here. The title of it is called Comfort of the Holy Spirit. The scriptural reading is John 14, verses 15 through 31. I'm gonna read just verse 16. It says, I will pray the Father, and He shall give you another comforter, that He may abide with you forever. So it says, Jesus knew that He was going away, and that if He went away, it was expedient, it was necessary, it was important that another come in His place and continue to guide and teach them as He has been. You and me, I and you. This is a plan of divine order. So the Holy Spirit was to come. I want you to see what has taken place when the Holy Spirit comes. I will pray the Father that He shall give you another comforter, that you may abide with you forever, that He may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth Him not, neither knoweth Him, but you know Him, for He dwells with you and shall be in you.
Yes.
And I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. I don't know a word that could be fitting at this time as the word comforter. I want to take you with me into the coming of the Holy Spirit. After Jesus ascended into heaven, He asked the Father to send the Comforter. It was a necessary moment, a needy hour, a necessity. Why? Because the disciple would need comforting. How would they be comforted? The Holy Spirit would take the word of Christ and reveal it to them. What could help them as much as a word by the Spirit? For the Spirit is breath, is life, is a person, is power. He gives the breath of Himself to us, the nature of Him. How beautiful that when the Spirit came, He should be called the Spirit of Truth. Oh, if we would only let that Spirit sink deep into our hearts. Some people have wondered that if they were to take for the baptism of the Holy Spirit, if an evil power would come instead, or an evil power would possess them while they were waiting for the Holy Spirit. No, no, 1,000 times no. When you receive the Holy Spirit, you receive the Spirit of Truth, the Spirit that gives revelation, the Spirit who takes the word of Jesus and make them life to you. In your moment of need, He is the Comforter. When the Holy Spirit comes into your body, He comes to reveal the King, to assure you of His presence. So for those adults that have not received the Holy Spirit, it's important that you receive the Holy Spirit. For the Spirit is breath, is life, is a person, is a power. He gives the breath of Himself to us, and the nature of Him. So there shouldn't be any hesitation, any fear, any doubt to receive the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit comes into your body. He comes to reveal the King. Yes. The King. Yes. The King of Kings. Yes. Lord of Lords. Yes. And He assures us yes. of His presence.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. That is ready to receive the Holy Spirit that will give you power.
Thank you, God.
That will give you Himself. Again, I read that He gives the Spirit as your breath. He is a person. He is power. Does anybody want to receive the Holy Spirit? If you do, raise your hand.
Hallelujah. Everybody standing on your feet. Jesus, the precious of sin.
set me on fire from the inside, from the inside of me. 'Cause all I want is for you. Oh,
that we have seen God work in their lives the last 2 or 3 weeks. We want to get them all rebaptized. Amen. So we'll make that announcement perhaps something this coming Sunday. So happy for. Amen. Answer the prayer. Your daughter. Amen. Mother, what happened to you? You were kind of blessed too. Hey, yes. Okay, I'm almost tempted now, Sister Denise, to just take on back and let her get filled with the Holy Ghost. It's more important her leaving without it. Even just going back to Sister Denise and whoever else, Sister Winston, Sister Pearl. And it won't be long, maybe 3 or 4 minutes, and amen, you'll feel 10 times. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
We just thank God for His goodness. Isn't God good?
Yes.
Isn't God good? Amen. This young lady here, now who's it? Sister Winston?
Yes.
Oh, daughter, our granddaughter. She looks so young. I said, wow, amen, stand up in you. My God, Sister Winston's daughter. Glory, what did God give you here? Sister Winston. We've been praying about this.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I started coming to this church when I was 14. Before that, we lived in Pine Bluff, Arkansas. And Pastor Hill's brother, First Trinity Baptist Church, is the church that we first went to. So when we came here, we felt kind of lost. But we realized this was home.
Glory to your name.
I was very shy. But God had a plan for me that I didn't understand.
Hmm.
Yes, yes.
I would come up here and they found out I could praise dance.
Yeah, you know
what? So every chance I got, I would be up here. Praise dancing, realizing I was touching so many, but I didn't even know this. I haven't stepped through these doors in over 10 years. I'm 35 years old now. I have 5 children. Some of you have met my 16-year-old.
Yes.
That is 6'2" in primary. But I pray every day. I stay prayed up. I read the booklets that I still have. I make sure my sons read the word for themselves. I make sure that they are young men, and I do have 2 little young ladies as well. But there is so much, and I see so many young children in here. And it just brings me so much joy because I know what it is for me. But I haven't spoken in tongues. In about a good 16 years. First time I caught the Holy Ghost was in that third pew right there. First time I ever shouted. I could mimic anybody. I love church. I thought that was the best thing going. And it still is. He's been the devil. He has been pushing me away. Tell me, no, you don't have enough gas to go. You have to take your children here and there. Today I was determined to come in this church. Because I've been screaming to God, come back to me. He said, I never left.
Yes.
He said, I never left. You walked away. But I know you're still here. He showed that he's still in me. There's been some medical issues in my family that I thought was going to take my oldest son. Now that I'm dealing with them, we all began to pray for me and touch my son. My God. When I say the devil has been trying to take me out, for the past year and a half. I had an emergency C-section 1 week. 2 weeks later, I had a major car wreck that several discs in my spine. They didn't think I would be able to walk and move around, pick up my children, raise my children. And then they said I had tumors that needed to be removed. Then they said my son had two more tumors that needed to be removed. So I began to pray. And I kept praying. I said, God, I need somewhere to go. I need someone to fellowship with. And he said, you gotta go back home. And I practiced right down the street for basketball. And I would pass this church every time. And I would look over, look in the pastor's parking lot and see if the car was there. And I'm thinking, yeah, it's time to go home. I just want to say thank you and to see so many faces that I love your soul so much and y'all loved on me so much and y'all taught me lessons that y'all may not even realize y'all taught me that I never forgot and I have instilled in my children before.
All right, hallelujah. Praise you. First time I ever probably heard somebody talk that much, talk that fluently. She wasn't lost for words. Amen. Been out of fellowship, you know, for a long time. And amen. Getting rededicated their life back to God. You know, most times people just have a little something to say. Amen. But it just flowed out. Isn't that amazing? How the anointing of God is on our life. Amen. This is one service, y'all. The Lord did it.
Yes.
Amen. God used y'all. God used y'all. Amen. Praise God. We didn't have nothing to do with it. Praise God. So we just thank God for God using. The Bible says God working with them, confirming his word with what? Signs following. How many want God to work with you?
Amen.
Hallelujah. All right, we're about ready to go. Sister Eva, I guess you kind of started this last week. And when your talk today was so profound and it's so enlightening, I mean, you just shoot straight from the hip, weren't you? Hey, but I believe she's real. She said she's going to work in conjunction to get in this church field. I just believe that we're going to see the fulfillment of the words that she spoke. God just doesn't move arbitrarily. Sometimes it's the result of somebody, what, being on their face. How many can say amen? Tomorrow, yesterday, we had a knockout, drag out, amen, prayer meeting. And I believe that prayer is at the foundation of every move of God. If you want to see signs and wonders, and if you want to see miracles of the supernatural, just get people praying. Amen. Just get people praying. So we appreciate Sister Deborah. Amen. Praise her. We thought we might have a chance to talk to her today. I mean, she could talk to us today. Amen. But, amen. We'll be here another hour. Would that be all right? Amen. She spoke yesterday. I mean, it was a wonderful, wonderful. Amen. We're going to have to start tying y'all down and picking y'all up and sitting in front of y'all that second Saturday, fourth Saturday. Amen. Every fourth Saturday, amen, you won't believe what God is doing. Amen. We'll continuously. I love my prayer group too. On Tuesday and Thursday morning, all my prayer team on Monday night first, on Monday night prayer team. Amen. You ought to be happy. You ought to be glad and shout the victory. God is answering your prayers. Pastor Hill is stepping back a little bit. Hallelujah. And y'all getting them saved and filled with the Holy Ghost and praying. Y'all praying them through. I mean, it's showing up. Tuesday and Thursday morning crew. Hallelujah. Let's praise God for them. Now we got a Sunday morning group. A Sunday morning, 7:30 group. Raise your hand and say, praise the Lord.
people at 7:30 on Sunday morning. Hallelujah. Prayer fades your work, save the sick. You fix your friend with prayer, for righteous does what? Avail as much.
While I have the mic in my hand, this month has been the most amazing month that I've experienced since I've been here. All this has just been awesome. And Brother Sammy, let me say to you right quick, you know, life teaches us lessons. And there's a lesson in death as well. And I think you found out what that lesson is. To go out and do what you couldn't do for your friend. Because of his death, you led 3 people to Christ. You know, so keep that in your heart, that he didn't die in vain. Amen? So, Brother Dave back there. Tuesday morning, this young man stood right there while the rest of us went on with Tuesday morning service. He could not stop praying in the spirit. After he finally sat down, he was over there by himself. He was mumbling and praying in the spirit. When I was locking up Tuesday morning and I was going out the front, Sister Precious was driving. And Brother Dave was sitting in the passenger seat. I thought his head was hanging out the window. It was so amazing. So please, please, if you can come out on Tuesday and Thursday mornings, please join us. There's so many great things come out of Tuesday mornings, Tuesday and Thursday mornings. And I'm one of them. I say that because when I started here, I could not come to service on Sundays. I could only come on Monday nights. So when Pastor Hill told me that we have service on Tuesday and Saturday mornings at 5 a.m., at first I couldn't believe what he was saying. But then it was perfect for me. See, that's where I established my foundation in this ministry. And Tuesday and Thursday mornings I live for. If I could get up and go to work to be paid, it's not that hard to get up and go to work, to live, to come to church, to live. It's just so amazing. So many wonderful things happen before the sun come up. So please, please come out and join us. I've seen many of your faces here and there, and welcome you back. Come and join us and enjoy, all right? Amen.
All right, without Brother Travis, none of this would be happening, I don't think, because I'm late, sometimes I oversleep, sometimes I'm tired, and he's the only one that's always on time. Always on time. And then he watches the door, make sure that it's locked, and then he watches out of the window and let us in one by one whenever we decide we're going to show up. Without him, y'all, amen, y'all with it. Amen, because those that would come would get discouraged because I sure don't be here on time most of the time. Now I to him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God be glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Everybody said together, praise God.
Praise God. Amen.
And the word showed us that it's 3 groups of people that we're supposed to be ministering to. The unsaved, the backslider,
and the saved, to encourage the saved ones to stay encouraged. Don't get weary of well-doing. Continue to seek and to serve the Lord. So I'm excited of what God is doing because he's bringing us together. If you get a call, we're concerned about you, Pastor Hill. We're assisting Sister and Pastor Hill in these endeavors that the body, God is saying the body of NCC, the body of Christ, we need to come together. Where there's unity, there's strength. Because we have a job to do. We are well equipped in that sense. He has given us everything that we need for life and godliness. All the word, all the scriptures, all the packets he's given us. We are well.